Welcome, my dear students. Let us start our 45th lesson, and our topic is poetic techniques or figures of speech or poetic devices, part 3. Number 8 poetic device which we will discuss today, that is imagery. Imagery may be defined as the representation of a sensory experience through language. That means when language appeals to our sensory organs. In this poetic device, the words which refer to objects and qualities appeal to our senses, appeal to our five sensory organs or five senses, that is seeing, hearing, smelling, taste, feel and touch. That means related to eyes, related to ears, related to nose, related to tongue and related to skin. That means our five sensory organs. When words appeal, or language appealed our five sensory organs, as if we are seeing something, as if we are hearing something, when words are presented in such a manner, or when as if we are smelling something, as if we are tasting something, as if we are feeling or touching something, that poetic device is called as imagery. Hence we have five forms of imagery. So we have five types of imagery as per our five sensory organs. First is visual imagery. That means that is related to eyes. When words are as written and your words are presented and it seems as if you are seeing something, that's called as visual imagery. For example, a blue frocked woman. So an image of a woman comes in our mind wearing a blue frock. So since it's as if we are seeing her, someone wearing a blue frock, so it's called as visual imagery. Then next is sound imagery. It's as if it's appealing to our ears. Children were laughing. We know when it's laughing, so a sound comes in that. That is called as sound imagery. And sipping sugar cane. Sipping, it also refers to a particular sound. So it reminds us of a particular sound. So it's called as sound imagery. Imagery of smell. For example, the cupboard was smelling of mothballs. And when we read that it was smelling of mothballs, we know that it reminds us of a particular smell coming from naphthalene balls. So it reminds us of particular smell, so it's imagery of smell. So words are appealing to our sensory organ, and that is nose. Next is imagery of taste. They were sipping sugarcane. Sugarcane, it here refers to a particular sweet taste of sugarcane. It's as if we are tasting it. No doubt we are not tasting it that time, but it reminds us of a particular taste. So it's called as imagery of taste. Or this soup is very spicy, or it's hot and spicy. So it reminds us of a particular taste that is hot and spicy when something is full of chilies. So it reminds of a particular taste, that is called as imagery of taste. And then imagery of feel and touch. That's related to our skin. For example, the grass was warmed by sunshine. So warmed. So here we can again say that it refers to a particular temperature that is felt by our skin. So we can say it refers to our skin. So it refers to our five sensory organs. So it's imagery of feel or imagery of touch. Or she was feeling pain and pleasure together. So pain and pleasure, they are inward feelings, what we feel inwardly, but they also, we refer to them, we feel it, and then even in their impact comes on our skin as well. So that is also an example of imagery of feel and touch. So these are the five types of imagery when words or language, it appeals to our five sensory organs, and then it is as if we are visualizing, as if we are hearing, as if we are smelling, as if we are tasting something, as if we are feeling or touching something. The next poetic device is sarcasm. It's an ironical statement intended to hurt or insult. So we can say that it is It has actually got two meanings. One is surface meaning, but actually we mean the another, and that's quite opposite. So in other words, we can also say that it's a bitter or wounding remark. It is common form of mockery in ordinary day-to-day speech. For example, this is an example of sarcasm. A teacher to a child whose answer is obviously wrong, he says him brilliant. But he doesn't actually, we know that he doesn't actually mean brilliant, because when the answer is wrong, he doesn't praise the child. He actually says it, but its meaning is quite opposite. And that is called as sarcasm. So sarcasm is an ironical statement. No doubt the surface meaning is something else, but it actually the person wants to mean quite opposite. And it is intended to hurt or insult. It's intended to hurt or insult. That is called as sarcasm. The next one is satire. This poetic device examines vice and folly, that means defects, and but make them appear ridiculous or contemptible. That means when defects or we can say disadvantages or defects, they are presented in a ridiculous way, in a very funny way. That's called as satire. But it is directed against a person or a type and is usually morally censorious. So, but its main purpose is, we can say, not only to point out the defects and follies in a comic way, but also to make them realize that it is morally incorrect, so that they can morally correct it. That's why we say that it is directed and is usually morally censorious. That means in order that it should be corrected morally. It uses laughter to attack its objects, because it is when a person's vices, defects, and follies, they are made known, but they are known in a very, very funny way. For example, you must have gone through one of your chapters in the text, that is where forgetting where politicians, they are being mocked. But it's not just they are being mocked, actually. Yeah, the poet, the author has used the satire. The author has used satire in order to bring out to us, to the front, we can say to the readers, that present day politicians or statesmen, they are not as good as they should be. But he has done that, Robert Lind, in his essay Forgetting, he has done that in a very funny way, and that is an example of satire. So when somebody's defects are made known, but it is also at the same time that the person wants that it should be made now correct morally, but presents it in a very funny way, that's called as satire. Next is hyperbole. It's a figure of speech where emphasis is put on exaggeration. That means something is exaggerated, presented in a very larger form, we can say exaggerated. For example, and it's common in everyday speech. For example, there were millions of people at the cafe. But it's not that there were really millions of people at the cafe. It's when the people at the cafe, there were a lot of people at the cafe, but it's presented in an exaggerated way, so that we can make an image that when lot of people are present, how it appears. Or for example, 10,000 and 1,000 fruits to touch. There were 10,000 and 1,000 fruits to touch on the tree. But it doesn't really mean that there were really 10,000 and 1,000 fruits to touch. It just means that the tree was full of fruits. Or there were lot and lot of fruits on the tree. So that's called as hyperbole. There are various other poetic devices as well, but only these are useful for your, as per your syllabus. So we will end up our topic with this, and in our next topic we will start with some poem or with some piece of poetry. Till then, have a nice time, have a great day. Thank you very much.